In the years leading up to when I was diagnosed with cancer, you know, life was going pretty darn well. I mean, I had a great life. I was, you know, trained as a physician. I was trained actually as a social scientist. And my work really involved improving the quality of care, you know, really trying to understand the patient experience, or, you know, kind of where it worked and where it didn't. And so, you know, in the time leading up, I had a wonderful, beautiful wife, and we had two beautiful, amazing boys. It was an ordinary but a very blessed life. There had been some clues that something was wrong for several months leading up to it, but, you know, as my breathing continued to sort of get worse, you know, we finally got a chest x-ray, and, you know, initially you're a little bit numb, but all your coping mechanisms kick in, and so you're hoping that it turns out to be something else. And then, you know, you get the call that they've done the initial results, and you've got some kind of lung cancer, and it's metastatic. It's obviously already spread. And it's like a punch in the stomach. And you kind of, you hold it together initially, but when you actually get to the point of then having to communicate that to your wife, let alone talking to your kids, that's incredibly hard.
What we found out was this wasn't something you're just going to deal with. This was drawing a distinctly short stick. So it was stunning. It was terrified as a mom of two kids. And then occasionally we get the questions from one of them of, you know, when will Daddy be well? And you try to figure out what's the best answer for, you know, I think maybe we'll get through this. And we didn't ever tell them. About 1 in 20 people make it 5 years.
The survival rate was very low for that one, even with conventional treatment. As a husband, as a spouse, as a father, as a son, you want to be incredibly positive and hopeful. At the same time, as a physician, the writing was on the wall, so that was hard. A couple weeks later, I got this call from one of the research centers saying we had a new test that's not really yet on the books for a mutation called ROS1, which is in about 2% of the patients, and I had that mutation. And better yet, it was similar enough to the other mutations that they thought that medicine crizotinib, which had worked well for one mutation, might work for this one, and they actually were opening up a new trial, and one of the places they were doing this was at UC Irvine. So I was the second person in the world with the mutation I had who was trying this particular medication. Though it had only been about 3.5-4 weeks, the lung looked almost normal. The tumors were still there, but they were no longer active. They were not acting like cancer. At that point, it was not only like, okay, this stuff might work, and for me, there was a chance, but it really helped open the floodgates for a lot of other patients.
And it wouldn't have been possible without going into the trial. It wouldn't have been possible if Alan had said it's not worth giving this a shot. UC Irvine Health is a blessing. It is a tremendous resource, but it's provided so much phenomenal care to so many people, and it's made a difference for my family.
You know, you have this gem right here in Orange County with UC Irvine Health, where this is one of the leading centers in the world on precision medicine, on targeted therapy, on genetic testing and targeting of different kinds of cancer, in particular lung cancer. But the people here and the treatments I've received are a large part of why I'm still here, 5 years after getting what was supposed to be a terminal cancer. And you can't put words to it. Thank you, you know.